Namaskaram. It is my pleasure to introduce Swami Shankara Amritananda Puri today, who is a senior disciple of Sadguru Sri Mata Amritanandamayi Devi. He joined the Mata Amritanandamayi Mutt in 1991. He is an Ayurvedic physician by profession with a postgraduate degree in Kaya Chikitsa. He joined the Amrita School of Ayurveda as an assistant professor in 2004. And now he is a professor, principal, and medical director of Amrita School of Ayurveda. Swami Shankara Amritananda Puri is actively involved in the activities initiated by Mata Amritanandamayi Mutt and has been given charge of the Madurai Brahmasthana. He has traveled to Germany, Switzerland, and Spain to promote Ayurveda and Indian philosophy. He has conducted many workshops and seminars on Ayurveda. He is a teacher, physician and scholar in Indian philosophy. His interpretation of Lalita Sahasranama was aired by Amrita TV as a serial in their Sandhya Deepam program. His other areas of interest include the Bhagavad Gita, Lalita Sahasranama, and Saundarya Lahari, which he will be talking about today. You can please start now, Swamiji.
I will start with the small prayer from Saundarya Lahari. Om avidyanam antastimiram hiradvipanagari jaranam chaitanyastabhagamakaranta srutijalim dalidranam chintamanigunanika janmajaladho nimagnanam damshram adhivavarahasya bhavati bhavanitvam dasemayi vitradishtim sakarunam यदि स्त्रोत वाचन कथयति भवानी तदैव तस्मै दिशसि निजसा युज्य पदवी ब्रह्मेन्द्र स्फुटम गुणनीराजित पदाम ओम अमृतेश्वरी नमः. माय प्रोस्ट्रेशन्स अंडर द लोटस फीट ऑफ माय गुरु श्री माता अमृतानंदमयी देवी. My pranams to one and all who are participating in this program. On this auspicious Navaratri occasion, I will be speaking about Saundarya Lahari today. I will try to introduce it in a simple way. It will be useful for those who are scholars as well. Saundarya Lahari is attributed to Adi Shankaracharya. It is told that he went to Kailas and Lord Parameshwara himself gave this 100 slokas. And while he was coming back from Kailasa, Nandikeshwara didn't want this sacred great chant to come to an earthly level. So it is told that he tried to grab the palm leaves from Shankaracharya and only a portion of it could come to earth. That is, they are called as the Ananda Lahari, the first 41 verses. There are 100 verses. Generally, whenever acharyas create something, they do it in hundreds. Uma Sahasra, written by Kavyakanta Ganapati, has 1,000 verses. Narayaniyam by Merpathur Bhattadari has 1,000 verses and more. It is called as Shataka, but Shatadashakas, that means 10 into 100, but it is having more verses than that. When we chant Sahasranama, there is an Ayuta Sahasranama which contains 10,000 names of Lord Shiva, a great chant. When our acharyas do, they do it not in a very minimal way, but in a fairly lengthy way they do it. So Adi Shankaracharya created this great chant. He wrote about 100, because some 5 or 6 are attributed to Saundarya Lahari also. So, but as a general practice, the 100 verses are being chanted and popularized as Saundarya Lahari. It is a shataka. If you take Abhirami Antadi, it has got a shataka, 100 verses. If you take Mukha Panchashati, which is also a great Devi Stotra, it contains 500 verses. They are divided into 5 different headings: Arya Shatakam, Mandasmita Shatakam, Padaravinda Shatakam, Stuti Shatakam, etc. So, shataka is a style which is adopted by our acharyas. So, Adi Shankara also chooses this method to praise the Devi. He has written a commentary on Lalita Trishati. It is told that he tried to write a commentary on Sri Lalita Sahasranama, which is a very popular text, and asked his disciple to bring the textbook of Sri Lalita Sahasranama from his library. And the first time his assistant took the palm leaves, and that was Vishnu Sahasranama. Shankaracharya told that to bring Vishnu Lalita Sahasranama from the library second time. So the disciple went again and came back, and again it was Vishnu Sahasranama. 3-4 times the same thing was repeated, and Shankaracharya got annoyed. I am asking you to bring me Lalita Sahasranama. You are bringing me Vishnu Sahasranama. What is the reason? Generally, he is an obedient disciple. Some disciples will do the opposite of what the guru says. But he is not such a person. The disciple said, there is a small girl standing in the library. She is not allowing me to take the other one. She is asking me to give you this. I am not able to refuse her also. She is so enchanting. So Shankaracharya understood that it was Bala Triparasundari. And then it was divine will that he is not destined to write the commentary on Lalita Sahasranama. So, we understand that Shankaracharya wrote Saundarya Lahari in his later period in an ecstatic mood. The glory and the beauty are the two subjects that he deals in Saundarya Lahari. If you carefully read that, you will understand that the beauty is also explained in Saundarya Lahari, along with the nature of Devi is also being described. The yogic practices, which were very common during Shankaracharya's time, there are many branches, but the Samayachara was in great practice at the time, and he does not forget to mention those aspects, the yogic methods, meditating Devi in Shat Chakras. That is also a major subject in Saundarya Lahari, especially in the beginning verses from verse number 30 to 41. That is the subject that he deals. It is written in a meter called Shikharini, which is more difficult to be written. Still, he has chosen Saundarya Lahari. He has chosen to write in Shikharini Vritta. I will not say that it is very easy to by heart this, to understand this. The subject itself is not very easy because it is a Devi Bhakti. Shankaracharya himself says in the last verses, Karala Taralanam Asulabha. For those who are fickle-minded, for those who are not having a mind control, it is difficult to do worship of Devi. It is difficult to worship Devi. It is told that Sulabhagati, she is very easy to be attained. It is also told that she is Durgama. It is very difficult to attain her. They are contradictory. It is not necessary to have a scriptural learning how to become a pandit to worship Devi. You should be an erudite Sanskrit scholar. You should have learnt many scriptures, Shadangas, Vedangas. Not necessary. You should have a pure heart. You should consider, you should relate to Divine Mother as your own mother. That is the only requirement, for which purity of heart is the most essential thing that is required. If you have enough love in your heart, the remembrance of Devi is the most easiest thing in the world. If your heart is impure with kama, krodha, etc., lust and greed and lower ideas that a man can have, then it is most difficult to attain her. We should approach Devi as a small child approaches her own mother. And relate to her in that way. It doesn't mean that you should not understand her glory fully. Mahima Vismarana, it is called by the devotees. That should not happen. You must always know that she is the mother of the universe. She is the Brahmanda Janani. She is the creatress of this entire universe. She is Panchakritya Parayana. She is doing the five karmas. Srishti, Sthiti, Tirodhana, Samhara, Anugraha. Through her agents like Brahma, Vishnu, Rudra, Ishvara and Sadashiva. So without forgetting her greatness and glory, yet we must relate to her just like a small child feels free to relate with her own mother. She has given birth. She has nourished him with milk, with her own milk, with her own blood. She is carrying you in her own lap, in her own shoulders. So a very small boy, an innocent boy, is never afraid of her mother, even if she looks a little bit terrifying. Devi is very, very peaceful. She is very Shanta Swarupini. She is also Raudra Rupini. So both the terrifying aspect as well as the simple aspect are present in Devi. She is terrifying to the demons. She is very simple to her devotees. So, in this 100 verses, Shankaracharya combines a lot of the names of Devi. She combines lots of stories relating to Parameshwara, the Tripura Samhara many times, the Kama Dahana comes many times. There are, a book is assessed by its commentaries. Great people have written many commentaries. There are about 36 commentaries for Saundarya Lahari. There are 8 famous commentaries. I just read their names just for an understanding, academic understanding. Lakshmidhara commentary is there. Saubhagya Vardhini by Kaivalya Ashrama. That is also available. Aruna Modini, written by Kameshwara Suri, is available. Ananda Giriya, that is available in print. Talpatya Deepika by Mahadeva is available. Padartha Chandrika is available. Dindima commentary by Ramakavi is available. Gopala Sundari. It is a very special commentary. It is described in 2 ways. It is describing Sri Krishna. Also in another way, it is describing Devi. It is told to be written by Narasimha Swami. So it is both Devi Para and Krishna Para. Then there is Ananda Lahari by Gauri Kanta Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. Mostly it is dealing with Advaita philosophy, the Kashmiri Saivas, etc. As I told, it is written in Sikharani Vritta and Shankaracharya has got an Ashtotra Shata in which he is called as Saundarya Lahari Mukhya Bahustotra Vidhayakaya Namaha, meaning that among his works, one of the greatest of his works are Saundarya Lahari. So he is known by Saundarya Lahari for writing Saundarya Lahari. Hence, it is an important work. So there are about 36 commentaries, out of which I mentioned only 8. Because this book is published, all the 8 commentaries, they are all in Sanskrit and published by Kanchi Kamakoti Pitha. And there's a Tamil commentary to it. There is a Sanskrit commentary to it. Both are published in the same book. It's a great work done by a doctor called Radhakrishna Shastri. There are many more commentaries. There are in English also, there are good commentaries available. There are many commentaries which describe this as a tantric book. In every Saundarya Lahari book, you will find yantras and benefits, exaggerated, or I should not say exaggerated. If it is done by the adhikaris, it will give you those benefits, otherwise it will not. It depends upon the qualification of the particular seeker who is practicing it. So in many of the books, the major drawback I find is the yantras and the benefits, which are very, very specific to a particular sloka. They say like that, and then they ask you to do that. And a lot of astrologers, jyotishis are also practicing this, and some of them are misusing it also, collecting a lot of lakhs of money from innocent people, which is not the purpose of, I won't think that Shankaracharya would have written this great work, would have written this book, great book, for such practices. I will never agree to that. I chanted 2 slokas in the beginning because of my experience from Saundarya Lahari. I always do this as my prayer verses. Wherever I speak, whenever I speak, it is an Ayurvedic subject also. I use this prayer that makes me think about the purpose of Devi, the grace of Devi, how she works in every one of us. Those verses are Avidyanam Antastamira Mihradvipanagari. That is the verse I chanted. I met Amma in 1987. Second time I met her in a temple in Coimbatore. It was on a Kartika day. And as a casual visitor, I didn't know that Amma was visiting. Amma was having a program on that day. I visited an Ayyappa temple in the town. It was on a Kartika day, so thousands of lamps were lit on that particular day. So it is a very beautiful moment to witness that particular celebration by the devotees. But during that evening, I heard a bhajan in the distance. There is a small hall which can have an audience of nearly 200, 300 people. So it is in a slightly distant place from the temple. So I heard that sound through the loudspeakers that the tone and the sweetness of that bhajan was something different from what we usually hear. So I ran to that place and saw Amma for the second time. I was surprised because I didn't expect this to happen. And I could participate in that program. And an introduction was given to Amma. Introduction was given in that program, the middle of that program, stating that Amma has traveled from Mumbai direct. And she came by road. She came in a small van, along with her disciples, and directly came to the program spot. It's nothing new to Amma, but it happens usually. She doesn't take much rest as normal people will do. And the person was introducing her like this: Amma has come here without rest. The reason for her to come here is to light the lamps in the hearts of every devotee. He was pointing out that thousands of lamps we have lit in the temple premises. That's a good thing, but that is not enough. The darkness in the hearts ought to be removed first. The light has to be lit in the heart rather than outside. The avidya has to be removed by vidya. The avidya is darkness. Vidya is knowledge. The avidya has to be substituted or removed, replaced by vidya. That is the purpose of Amma's visit. That is the purpose for which Amma is struggling all the 24 hours for her devotees. Avidyanam antastimira mihira dvipanagari. She is the sunrise which removes, this dispels the darkness or avidya from the hearts of our devotees. So I always remember this. It happened some 40 years before, but still I remember that whenever I see Amma speaking to someone, maybe she is speaking mundane things, maybe she is speaking very normal things, not spiritual advices always. I will remember she is taking that effort to attach the devotee to her so that he will become a little better. The prarabdha, or to remove a sin, or to remove something, to remove a negativity from her devotee, is a great thing for Amma. All our Mahatmas will go to any extent to help the devotees so that they come up in their life, they come up in their spiritual life. So that is the purpose for which they are struggling 24 hours. This is the common nature of all our Mahatmas. So to remove the prarabdha of someone, They will go to any extent. They will try their level best to bring him up, to raise him up, to remove his negativity, to bring some positivity. So I always remember this particular verse, and it is always inspirational for me to chant this sloka before starting any meeting or any program or any speech or classes, whichever I have to do. The second sloka I chanted was Bhavani Tvam Dase Mayi Vitra Drishtim Sukarunam Iti Stotum Vanchan Kathayati Bhavani Tvam Iti Yaha Tadaivatvam Tasmai Dishasi Nijasa Ayujya Padavim Mukunda Brahmendra Sputamukudani Rajita Padam. So a devotee is praying to Mother, praying to Divine Mother. Hey Bhavani, I will go to a little bit of grammar here. A little bit, not too much. Hey Bhavani is called as Saptami Ekavachana. It is how you call in Sanskrit. Oh Bhavani, oh Mother, oh Divine Mother. Oh the concept of Bhava. That is how you call them. If you call Mata Amritanandamayi Devi, Hey Mata Amriteshwari, like that you call. If you call Shiva, Hey Rama, Hey Shambhu, Hey Hari, like this you have to call. This is called a Sambodhana Prathama. Seventh case. So the devotee is beginning to call her like this. Hey Bhavani, kindly bless me with your glances, with your merciful glances. Vitara Drishtim Sukarunam, like that. He is praying the Divine Mother so that she blesses him with her merciful glances. So that is his purpose. He is just beginning to call him. There is another case which is called as Lot Pratyaya in Sanskrit. In a particular tense, if you say Bhavani, it means that I should become you. It is called as Lot. Bhavani, Bhavava, Bhavama, let me become yourself. There can be two meanings for the word Bhavani. One is the Sambodhana Prathama. The second one is, let me become you. It's a Kriyapada or it's a verb. So Devi does not consider the first meaning. She takes the second meaning of the devotee. This devotee is praising me. He is praying that he should get a Sayujya. He should become myself. There are four mukti: Samipya, Salokya, Sarupya, Sayujya. The devotee is praying for the highest position, or he wants to become myself. He wants to become Devi herself. It is told in the Dhyana Slokas that Ahamityeva Vibhavaye Maheshim, I should become you. During that prayer, that is the way the bhavana or the imagination should be. Imagining oneself to be Devi, it is called as Aikyanu Sandhana in Sakta Sampradaya. But Devi does not take the first meaning. She takes the second meaning and blesses him with Sayujya, which is very difficult even for Mukunda, Brahma, Indra, etc. I am telling a very brief meaning of the particular verse. The prayer of the devotee is something different, but the interpretation of Devi is entirely different. That is what I am trying to convey here. I will narrate again an incident from my life. I met Amma in 1987, and then in 1988 or in the beginning of 89, I joined the MD course in Trivandrum, and it got finished in 1991 end. December or something, February or something, 92 February. So after that, I had no job in Trivandrum. I had a job in Coimbatore, so I thought I will go back to that job and join the job there. So I came to Amma Everybody used to say that you have to be very open to Amma, you have to tell everything, you have to get her permission for everything, you have to seek her blessings for everything. So I thought I was associated closely with her. Every week at least once I will meet her. So I thought I will inform this to Amma that I am going to Coimbatore for my job and for my career. So it was in a small hut. Amma was giving her darshan. As usual, she hugs everyone and listens to whatever they have to say, and then she blesses them by giving a prasad. That is the usual method. So my turn came, and I was trying to say that I tried my level best to have spiritual, to do my spiritual sadhana when I was studying in Trivandrum. I thought the 3 years of my life I will dedicate to God and try my level best. I did not give much attention to MD studies, as I was a good student, but I was more focused in spiritual practices than in studying. So once the study was over, I thought I'll go back to job and try to continue my spirituality from there. But Coimbatore was a long distance from Amma's ashram. So definitely I will not have more chances to come as I used to come from Trivandrum. It is just a 2.5 hours distance. Whereas Coimbatore is more than 8 hours of travel. Also, when I go for a job, I will not be able to, I will have to do justice to the job rather than spirituality. That also was going on in my mind. So I told that I just started conversing with Amma that my study is over in Trivandrum and I am going to Coimbatore. She didn't allow me to speak any further. She will usually say, yeah, please go and come once in a while, like that and all. I was expecting that because I was not a very important person. All the spiritual practices that I did was not revealed to anyone. Nobody knows about it. So I thought my mom may not recognize me much, and she will allow me to go, and she will bless me with some prasad. And be a fruit or something. That's how she usually does. So I told that I am leaving to Coimbatore for my job. So, sir, but unexpectedly she asked me, oh, have you had enough of spirituality? That's all you want to do for spiritual things, a spiritual sadhana? Are you discontinuing your spiritual sadhana? Like that she asked. So I was taken aback. I didn't know I didn't know what I had to do. If I had to stay in Trivandrum, I had to get a job and it is more difficult. I didn't want to do that. So I didn't know what I have to say. But I just requested that, Amma, are you asking me to stay in the ashram? Just asked us, Imla, yes, something like this. And she said, yes. So I understood that she is wanting me to join the ashram and continue my spiritual practices. So I said, I will do that, but I have a job in Coimbatore, so shall I resign that? Like that I asked. Amma said, yes. I have not informed my parents about my decision to stay in the ashram. So shall I tell them a half-truth that I'll be serving a mutt in ashram for some 3-4 years, not for my lifetime? So that was another question I asked Amma, and she said, yes, that is how you have to take, you have to say, you have to present everything mildly to your parents. So I said, I will go to my parents and then inform them and then come back, and I did the same thing. So how I am relating this to Sundar Lahari is, I was trying to convey something. Amma was taking another stand. She was conveying me something else, something higher. I was looking for a job. She was talking about moksha. We are looking for material prosperity. We are always going to Amma with materialistic problems. But along with material prosperity, she is helping you to become spiritual as well. So you ask something, she gives you much more than what you ask for. Bhayat tratum datum phalam apicha vancha samadhikam. Even if you do not desire, even if you do not want, the hita is being done to you. So the devotee asked Bhavani, "Hey Bhavani." Devi took it as Sayujya. He is speaking as if he is talking the Upanishad Mahavakyas. Aham Brahmasmi, Tat Tvamasi. He wants to become one with me. Like that she took a stand and then blessed him with such a blessing. So Saundarlahari Parayana, understanding Saundarlahari, thinking about Saundarlahari, Manana, Shravana, Nididhyasana, meditating upon Saundarlahari is of great benefit. It helps you to understand the nature of Divine Mother. It helps you to nourish your devotion, so that the half devotion becomes complete. Ardha bhakti becomes purna bhakti. This is a method which is adopted by the previous seekers who worship Saundarlahari. I will tell one more example. Vipanchagayanti, it is the 75th verse. Vipanchagayanti vividhamapadhanam pashupatehe. Tayarabdhe vaktum chalita sarasa sadhu vachane. Tadiyair madhuryaihi apalabita tandriyakalaravam nijam veenam vaanim nichalayati cholena nibhratam. This is a verse which is repeatedly chanted by the musicians of India. Nija sallapa madhurya vinirbhatsita kachapi, there is a name in Lalita Sahasranam. This particular verse and that particular sloka, both are having the same meaning. It is told like a story, a small story. Once Saraswati was playing her veena in the darbar of Devi. She was singing the glories of Lord Shiva. She was also playing her veena, Kachapi veena, Vipanchi veena. She is the goddess of music. Devi Saraswati is the goddess of music. She is also playing her favorite veena. She is also singing the glories of Lord Shiva, which are very sweet and for which Devi is very much fond of. So it is like a double sweetened milk. Shiva's glories are being sung. Sakshat Saraswati is singing them in her own sweetest of voices. And also she is playing the veena. Whenever you sing, if you use an harmonium, it sounds sweeter. When you sing with a string instrument, veena is the best of the string instruments. It's doubly sweet. So everyone were enjoying, including the Devi. So as a part of appreciating it, Devi was trying to say sadhu. Sadhu means nice, very nice. She was beginning to say that particular word, sadhu. She did not complete it because the first swara in Sangeeta is Sargama Padanisa. Sa is the first swara. And she started saying that. And her voice was so sweet that everybody started at everybody turned to Devi and started attending to her sweet voice. What Amma is going to say? What Devi is going to say? And Saraswati felt a little bit ashamed, a little bit insulted, because the focus of the attention of everyone turned to the voice of the sweet voice of Devi. So her voice is sweeter than the sweetest songs, the sweet song of Saraswati herself. So this is what the particular verse means. So the Nijasallabha Madhurya Vinirbhatsa Gachabi also means the same. The casual talks of Devi is sweeter than the sweet music of music that is coming from Kachapi Veena. So this particular chant is also being repeated, being practiced as a sloka, which helps in developing the music, the musical talent of musicians. So they practice it consistently, they practice it regularly. They chant it many times. Maybe in their concerts, they will chant this sloka in their minds. So this is a practice. So I showed three examples here. Avidyana Mantasmira Mihradipanagari Bhavani Tum Dasemai Vidradashtim Sukarunam Ripanchaga Inti Vividam Avadhanam Pashupatehe. So I can give more examples, but as the time is very short, I am restricting myself to three examples. So, a general chanting of all the slokas of Saundarya Lahari can be done. Or, the 41 slokas, which is called as Ananda Lahari, can be chanted in a stretch. And then, the 59 verses, which is called as Saundarya Lahari, can be chanted later. This way, you can chant either Saundarya Lahari totally, 100 slokas, which may take an hour or so. Or you can chant 41 slokas and 59 slokas in a separately, in a single day. Just like we chant Lalita Sahasranam every day, that is also possible. That may take again maybe 20 minutes or so. Or the slokas can be used as prayers. Prayer slokas before you start something, before you deliver a lecture or before you do something. So that way also Saundarya Lahari can be used. Anyway, it is important to understand all the slokas, to by heart all these slokas, to listen to them, all these slokas. I learned it much later in my life. When some interpretations I saw by Kanchi Paramacharya about Saundarya Lahari, I got so interested. They were like explanations of Lalita Sahasranama. So for 6 months, every day I used to listen to all the 100 slokas, just Shravana, listening to the slokas. They were quite difficult for me, even if I'm having some basic knowledge in Sanskrit. Some slokas, you know, they break your teeth. Sunny day, yachaya, churana sabalam, chandra shakalam, dhanu shavna siram, kimitina, nibadhanati, dishranam. It's very difficult. If I ask any new person, if I chant this particular sloka, Gatair Manikyatam Gaganamani Visandra Gatitam, he will not understand anything. Definitely he will not understand. Even a moderate scholar in Sanskrit also will find it difficult to understand. Why they are composed in such a way? There is a reason for that. These slokas are having their own mystic divine powers. It is not enough if you just understand the sense or meaning. It is necessary that you should worship it. You should have an upasana of the same thing. You should do it regularly. You should repeat it many times. So they are made into a more difficult ones. So that to understand them itself, you have to read it many times. To by heart them, which was the system in system traditionally, it takes more time. To understand the beauty, to have multiple meanings, the same sloka I interpreted in some way, it can be interpreted in a different way. That is why I was talking about the different commentators. There are about 36 commentaries available even today. There would have been many more which we have lost because there is a lack of interest for our people. We have become more materialistic. We have become less inclined to learning Sanskrit scriptures. We are doing a lip service. We are more attracted by superficial English expressions. Our language itself has lost its beauty, be it Malayalam, be it English, be it Tamil, especially in the metros where they speak either Tanglish, in Malayalam we call it as a Manglish. The accuracy is never practiced properly. Onam, I see many of the girls and boys who are studying in our colleges, they say Onam. That na is not pronounced properly. Ra is never pronounced properly in Tamil Nadu. There are many more spelling errors. We are not very careful about our language. We are fascinated. Anything told by a Western person is accepted as scientific. English is a language, it's not a science. So anyway, that is not the topic today. So some of the slokas in Sandar Lahiri are very difficult. Some of the slokas are very easy. It is having the quality of a great chant or stotra. A good stotra should have 6 elements. Namaskaram, Ashirvachanam, Siddhantaha, Parakramam, Vibhuti, Prarthana. All these are there. I can tell examples, but the time is not allowing me to do so. So, I had a request from Srimati Deepa that I should explain 190th verses. So, I will spend about 10 minutes to that. The first sloka is Shiva Shaktya Yukto Yadi Bhavati Shakta Prabhavitam Nache Devam Devo Nakhalu Kushalas Panditamavi Atastvam Aradhyam Harihara Virinchadi Bhirapi Pranantum Stotum Vakatham Akrita Punya Prabhavati. This sloka is fairly simple. This is the very first sloka in Sandar Lahari. Shiva and Shakti are inseparable. Without Shakti, the Shiva will not be even able to move. I'm trying to find a quotation from the Vedas. And because without the Shakti, the Shiva will not be able to move. How can a person without merit, with great meritorious acts in his past lives, can even worship or praise Devi? Pranantum Stotumva. How can he prostrate? How can he worship? How can he praise the greatest Devi? So the meaning is very simple. So I'm not going to explain it word by word. I will again narrate an incident which happened in the life of Kanchi Paramacharya. Once a Vedic sadas was conducted in Trichy. In view, all the great scholars were called from all over India. There are about 100 great scholars who were present during that time, for that program, which it is called as Vidvat Sabhas, which will happen for 3 days. So a lot of scientific discussions or Shastra discussion will happen there. So in which Kanchi Paramacharya himself was presiding. So it was an important meeting for everyone. So Kanchi Paramacharya looked at all the scholars who were present there. All of them are erudite scholars. And he did not find one person who was one of the greatest scholars. But he was very old, that is why he could not come. He was 90 years old at that point of time. So Kanchi Paramacharya told that particular name, why you did not call him? Why he is not here? Why that Shastri is not here? So everyone told that he is having some asthma and he is very old, he is not able to sit for a long time, that's why he could not come. So the Vidvat Sabhas has not commenced at that point. So Kanchi Paramacharya wanted that person to be brought because he belongs to Trichy, the same place. So he ordered them, he said that, to tell that I myself have asked him to come. So bring him here. Without his coming over here, we will not start the sadhas. So they went and saw that person, he was sick, he was having wheezing, he was overweight and he could not come. He had his own reasons for not coming. But then because Kanchi Paramacharya himself has told, so he somehow prepared himself and came there. And immediately Kanchi Paramacharya received him and asked him to start the sadhas. At this point, that person told that he is not able to chant the Vedic chantings because he was having breathing trouble. He will not be able to complete a Ghana Patha or something, a very long stotra, a very long chant. Shankaracharya told him to chant a prayer, some other prayer. So he chose this particular verse, Shiva Shaktya Yukto Yadi Bhavati. Shakta prabhavitum nachay devam devo nakhalu kushalaspanditum api atastvam aradhyam harihara virinchadibhirapi pranantum stotum vagatham agrita punyam prabhavati. So with that prayer, the Vidvat Sadas started and it went on for 3 days. And during the discussions on third day, Shankaracharya was putting a question. See, we witnessed an event in this program. Somebody, Vidvat Sabhas, Vaidika Sadas, a discussion about the Vedas started in an Avaidika way. It was Stotra. It was started by chanting from Saundarya Lahari, which is a Stotra. So generally, the Vedic scholars will not accept that. The highest pramana or the highest authoritative text is Vedas. So we must have started with a Vedic chant rather than a stotra. How many of you are disagreeing to this? How many of you are not happy with this? Like that the question was asked to all the Vedic scholars who were present. Nobody could answer because that person was brought by Shankaracharya that person expressed his inability to do a Ganapatha from Vedas. Shankaracharya himself agreed to a Sloka Parayana from Saundarya Lahari. Now he is asking this question. Are you accepting this, or some of you are not happy or like that? This was the content. So nobody answered. And Shankaracharya himself explained. That is a Vedic quotation from Rudra. This is a part of Vedas. In the middle of the Rudra, there's a verse. Yate Rudra Shiva Tanu Shiva Vishwaha Beshaji Shiva Rudrasya Beshaji Tayono Mrida Jeevase. Which means the body of Lord Shiva and Devi are one. They are inseparable. She is the medicine. She is the medicine for Rudra. Without Devi, he does not live. Lord Shiva cannot live. Which is something similar to the expression in Saundarya Lahari. Without Devi, the Shiva cannot live. That is the expression. Nakhalu kushala spanditamapi. He will not be able to move. So Shankaracharya was quoting this particular verse from Rudra, stating that the same sense is being expressed by Shankaracharya, the Adi Shankaracharya. So the Veda Patha as well as the Stotra Parayana are not different. They are all essentially the same. So this was the justification given by Kanchi Paramacharya, who was a very great scholar, as everyone knows. So it is authoritative. What I am trying to state here is the Saundarya Lahari is as authoritative as Vedas itself, Vedas themselves. So then there is no need for any confusion whether it is a parayana of a lesser version of sloka or something. It is not lesser than a mantra. It is as powerful as the Vedic chants are. So that is the point I am trying to drive here. Then I will explain about the 90th verse. Dadane dinebhya sriyamanisham asanu sadashim amandam saundarya prakaramakarandam vigirati tavaspin mandaras tabakasubhage yatucharane nimajjan majjeeva karana charanata shacharanata. I will not be able to explain word by word. I will briefly explain the meaning. O Devi, O Bhagavati, you benefit your devotees in the way they want, in a limitless way. You are like a wish-fulfilling tree. Let me become a kind of a bhramara or a beetle with six legs, and then enjoy the sweet honey that is present in your lotus feet. Your feet is like a lotus which is filled with immortal nectar. Let me become a beetle, let me become a bhramara and enjoy the sweetness, and let me become a student. Let me surrender unto your feet. This is the basic prayer. It is a prayer. Shankaracharya wants to become a Brahmara or a beetle, an insect with six legs. Similarly, we have the five Pancha Jnanendriyas and one mind. We become a small insect. That beetle, honeybee, enjoys the sweetness in a flower. Similarly, we enjoy the knowledge, the sweetness of knowledge that is present in the Devi's legs, just like a lotus. And she always blesses her devotees with whatever they want. She is like a wish-fulfilling tree. So, this is the prayer. This is a prayer song. This is the meaning of the 90th verse. Dadane dinebhya shriyam anisham asanu sadashim. There is no limit to the blessings of the Divine Mother. The Shreyas is being given to all her devotees in an unlimited way. Asanu sadashi. Whichever way they want, it is being given by them. Just like a wish-fulfilling tree. If you sit under that, all your wishes are fulfilled. All the purusharthas, the chaturvidha purusharthas, dharma, artha, kama, and moksha, are in the feet of Divine Mother. Generally, the devotees say that bhakti is the fifth purusharthas. The devotion is the fifth purusharthas. Nishkama bhakti, a devotion without any expectation from Devi. That also you can get under that particular tree. Kaliyam kalpaga vrikshachivattingal chetasse mella nadanjallam thayadan keedilai veenu kidakkunna naalu purushartham shekharikkam. The dharmartha kama mokshas are just lying under that particular tree, which is Devi herself. So we need not have any special prayers, any specific request. We have to worship her just out of love and devotion. And then Amma takes care of everything else. We should become like a honeybee, enjoying the sweetness of the love of Devi. We must surrender unto her lotus feet. So that is the general meaning of the particular verse. So similar interpretations can be given instead of complicating them into tantric interpretations. So we can look for devotional interpretations, and then because I explained about 5-6 verses from Saundarya Lahari today. Each one are different. Their flavor is different. So just to give you an example that many aspects, the various aspects of Devi is dealt in Saundarya Lahari. So chanting all the 100 verses will be taking you showing different colors, different flavors, different aspects of Devi, different natures of Devi, and then it is very, very difficult to be uninspired after listening to Saundarya Lahari. At some point you will become inspired. At some point your mind will become filled with the devotion. Because all the aspects are being described. The beauty, the glory, the power, the tantric aspects, various stories, various names, very beautiful names. So, this is a very inspiring and soul-stirring experience if you listen, if you understand it correctly, if you take efforts to understand it properly. So this way, the nikama bhakti, nishkama bhakti, the devotion without expectation, will be kindled in those who are chanting it. They will attain mental peace, a steadiness of purpose in your life. Your whole life will be dedicated to Divine Mother, which is the greatest thing that can happen to you. So, with these few words, I offer all my words to the lotus feet of Amma. I offer these divine thoughts to the lotus feet of Amma. I am thankful for the organizers for having called me for this program. And during this special occasion of Navaratri, it's an honor for me to share my thoughts on Divine Mother. It's more easy to talk about Bhagavata stories, whereas to talk about the divine nature of Mother is somebody needs a lot of focus. So I'm thankful for this opportunity. So I pray that everyone will be blessed with Sarvakshem, with all that is auspicious and good. Thank you very much.
Actually, it is we who should thank you for taking the time and giving two lectures at such short notice on such beautiful topics during Navaratri. So thank you very much. We truly appreciate it. And Swamiji, we'd be happy if you could end also with a prayer and a slokan.
So I will end with a sloka from Samudra Lahari. प्रदीपज्वालाभिर्दिवसकरनीराजन विधिः सुधासूते चन्द्रोपलजललवैलघ्यरचनां स्वकीयैरम्भोभिस्सल्यनिधिसौहित्यकरणं तदीयाभिर्वाग्भिस्तव जननिवाचां स्तुतिरियम् ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ लोका समस्ता सुखिनो भवन्तु लोका समस्ता सुखिनो भवन्तु लोका समस्ता सुखिनो भवन्तु शांति शांति शांति।